All right. Hi, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to get started before I forget what I wanted to say. My name is Vika Abrecht. I am a software engineer, and I work for Bloomberg. I am part of machine learning team, and I lead a group of people that works on text analytics at Bloomberg. I will ask questions to make sure that you're paying attention. So my first question is, as a show of hand, who knows Bloomberg as the company? Good. My support group over there, of course, my colleagues, and many of you, actually. Bloomberg as a company. You may know Bloomberg as the president, the mayor of New York, right now, the former mayor of New York, who started a company 30 years ago. And the company's name is Bloomberg. And we are a global company with the main headquarters in New York. And generally, if you're a software engineer in New York, you have two choices. You can work for the main industry of the city, which is finance, or you can work for a pure technology company. So you can join a bank or a hedge fund or a prop trading firm, and you can help build technology that services financial professionals and individuals who are players in the market. Or you can join a company like Google, for example, or Amazon, Facebook, or a technical startup that build their business around creating a software product. The software product that generates revenue or will generate revenue in the future. So you, as a software engineer, contribute to building that product. Now, Bloomberg falls right in the middle. We are a technical company. Our main product is a software tool, this giant software platform that has a lot of data and tools that analyze this data, visualize it for you, let you run computations and search this data. But we are also in a finance, in the sense that many of our clients are financial professionals and financial institutions. And much of our data is financial data. So when working for Bloomberg, you can build your career as a technologist. You can specialize in infrastructure, UX, machine learning, or building real-time distributed applications. You can also choose to learn about finance a little bit or a lot. Or you can learn enough to become financially savvy and save a lot of money really fast, retire when you're 30, and go travel the world. That's also an option. My personal goal, but I missed the deadline. But not everything is lost. All jokes aside, I'm building my career at Bloomberg as a machine learning engineer. Machine learning is the area that I picked. How many of you have taken a machine learning class, as a show of hand? A few of you. How many would like to take a machine learning class? All right. It's a growing field, a very exciting field, with so much impact in our daily life and so many applications, from spam detectors to contributions to robotics and autonomous systems, computational biology, yet has so much potential in the future if you just let your imagination run wild. There's so many future applications. Machine learning, as some of you may know, looks for patterns in data. It builds models that encapsulate those patterns, and then those models can make predictions and make decisions in the future. Now, my team and I work on text data. We try to make sense of news stories, social media, Twitter. We try to understand the signals that are contained in that data. And that's where sentiment analysis comes in. I guess I should start using my slides. This is our headquarters in New York. So we receive a lot of news stories at Bloomberg. And one time, we asked ourselves a question. Does news affect financial markets? How many of you know what the stock market is here? Right? How many of you think that stock market is boring or complicated? Honestly? All right. It's actually quite simple. So you know that companies like General Electric's, GM, Ford, they issue shares, which are called stocks. These stocks, they have a particular price, and the price fluctuates based on company's performance and other economic factors, micro and macroeconomic factors. And what you can do, what anybody can do, including you, you can buy these shares and you can sell these shares, and you either make money or you lose money. Now, why is it interesting? Why should it be interesting for you? Stock market has a very interesting property. It always goes up. And you may think I'm crazy for saying this, because we all know that the Great Depression, the dot-com crisis, the recent mortgage crisis, right? And of course, we had very significant market crashes and people lost money. But if you look over a long period of time, over the history of market, over the past 200 years, it always goes up. If you invest long-term, market goes up, and that's what makes it very attractive for many people at certain points of their life. People put their retirement money in the market, people put their savings in the market, and a lot of times, it's, if you know at least a little bit what you're doing, it's a much better decision than just leaving cash in your savings account. And that's why it is interesting, or becomes interesting for many people at some point of their lives. So this is an example, back to news and sentiment. This is an example of a day in a stock price of one major investment bank. This crash happened on the day where SEC, which is a Securities Exchange Commission, which is an administrative regulatory agency, announced an investigation against this company. And you can see that first Bloomberg headline came out, then followed by New York Times, and within the next 15 minutes, the stock price dropped by 12%. This is very significant. And that was triggered by the news that was published in Bloomberg. And these are the kind of signals that we're trying to pick up. There are many ways to pick up signals from news market, and I don't have time to cover different products that we have, but sentiment is one of them. Sentiment analysis looks at news stories and tries to understand if a story is positive or negative for a particular company. So we start with individual stories, and we receive them after they have been tagged with companies that they talk about. We analyze, our algorithms analyze the story, and they try to tell if the story is positive or negative for companies like Twitter, LinkedIn, and Facebook. And then we aggregate those statistics and we build a real-time indicator that is like a graph. And you can see how sentiment of a company changed over a day or over a week or a month. Now, there are two parts to this, classification and aggregation. And the more interesting part is classification, where we produce a model for that is able to classify individual stories. And that's what I'm going to focus on today, because that involves machine learning. So some of you may know that supervised machine learning learns from labeled data, builds models, and then is able to make predictions. And that's exactly what we do. To get started, we need to get a lot of training data, labeled data. So we need to show our algorithm stories that are positive and negative for companies in the past. How do we get there? We ask humans, people, to take a look at the stories and produce the labels for us. But before we can do that, we need to understand what positive and negative means. We need to ask the right questions. And sometimes it's not very straightforward. For us, we think of our investors, people who have a little bit of money. They want to get a signal from news, is it positive or negative for the company, and make decisions about buying or selling stocks that would make them a lot of money. But sometimes it's not straightforward. So in our world, positive means the stock will go up for the company. Negative for the company means the stock will go down. Right? But sometimes it's not straightforward. For example, job cuts. It sounds negative, but in reality, it not always is for the stock price. If a company acquires another company, is it positive or negative for the company that is acquiring and being acquired? Are high earnings always positive, or is it tied to the expectations of the market about a particular earnings of a particular company? Those are all the questions that we need to answer before we go to our annotators and ask them to label data. Then they produce the labels for us, and we build a machine learning system. I don't have time to go in a lot of technical detail here, but one question you might be wondering is that how can we represent documents to an algorithm in order to build a model? And for that, we use vector space models. So we represent each document as a vector in a multi-dimensional space. And the space is determined by the features. And the features in this case would be sometimes as simple as just the vocabulary, the words that we see in text. So if you imagine a very simple example where you have documents that only mention cats and dogs, two words, nothing else, you can represent each document in this two-dimensional space by counting the number of times the word dog and cat appears in each document, right? So you will see that documents that mention mostly dogs will be at the bottom right, documents that mention mostly cats will be at the top left. This is a simplistic view of what happens behind the scenes. We take each document and they are not two-dimensional, but sometimes the dimension is thousands or tens or hundreds of thousands of words, and we represent each document by encoding whether the word is present or absent in the text. And from there, we go to build a classifier, which is technically looking for a separating hyperspace or a line in a two-dimensional space that kind of separates positive and negative examples, positive and negative stories. Okay, so we do the same thing for Twitter, but we build a separate model for Twitter because Twitter uses quite different language. And this is an example of a tweet that you may remember or may not remember when there was breaking news and there were explosions in the White House. It was a fake tweet. Somebody just posted it as a lie on Twitter. And this was the impact on the stock market. So it crashed temporarily before people realized that it never happened, and then it recovered. So paying attention to Twitter is also important, and that's why we build a model for Twitter, and we have separate sentiment feed for tweets. So for tweets, it's a little different because the text is short. There's a lot of non-standard language, slang, mistakes, emoticons. So the feature set that we use for Twitter is quite different. You can see that Twitter language is a little bit difficult to understand, maybe if you're seeing it for the first time. It's quite different from what reporters use when they write news stories. So once you determine which features are important, then you do the same thing as you do for news. You label the data, you train the model, you build the classifier, and then you're able to take a look at new examples and produce your labels, positive or negative. And this is the screen on Bloomberg that shows social velocity, monitors velocity on Twitter, and as well as shows how many positive and negative and neutral tweets for a particular company came out in the recent past. I don't have a lot of time to answer your questions. If you have any questions, I will be available after the presentations. But thank you very much. Hope this was helpful. Bye.